going, everyone? Geoff Chrysler here, a detail enthusiast and owner of Rightway Heritage Trimming. Here with our next client, this Austin Healey BJ8. It drove all the way here from Ontario. This is belongs to good friends, James and Rachel Edney. And yeah, they've driven it all the way across the country to visit their daughter and have me install their new interior and top. So I'll be here for the next few weeks getting all that done. So let's get into our first step. We gotta remove all of his, his top and what interior is still left in the car so that I can get into installing the new stuff. Okay, so moving right along here, we've got all of the interior stripped out so I can start reinstalling some of the new. As you can see, James already installed a bunch of that hush mat stuff, insulation stuff throughout the cabin. So that's all ready to go. So now I can just start gluing in the jute pieces, as you see here. I'll start with gluing them in up in the tow board areas there, and then work my way back, start adding carpet as well. So. I think I am going to redo that shift dome. As you can see, the join there is not so great, so I'm going to take that off and redo that. And just work my way back, adding jute and carpet and then panels. So I've just been gluing in the jute pads, insulation, all over the firewall and footwells. And then once you get the jutes glued in place, you can glue in the sill next. So you can see on this side, I've already done that. I put in the sill carpet and it just goes forward and underlaps the tow board carpet there. And then you can install the tow board carpet, which is one big piece of carpet that does all of this. And so it does a 90 degree bend in that inside corner, and it's already pre-cut to do what it needs to do in the top edge. So you just put it in there and bend it around, gluing it to the jute, and it tucks under this big fiberglass tunnel section. So you can see on the other side, I had to cut back the jute some because he's got a really thick seal here. So in order to get this pushed up far enough so that the holes will all line up, I had to reduce some of the thickness underneath of it. So it's jute as much as I can there, but I've cut the jute to go around this shape so that the carpet just floats over and under. So. Not a problem. And then now that this is in place, I can poke through the holes and remount that headlight dimmer switch. Okay, so tow board carpets are all in, as you can see, and sill carpets are in. So that's all done. I've now fastened down the main gearbox tunnel with its screws, and it's a nice tight seal up against the carpet there. And as you can see, I've laid in the jute for the main floor mats and cut out around where the snaps go. I just punch out circles there so they just sandwich underneath so you can lift them out easily if they ever get wet. And in the back here, I've put in these the bump boxes, and they have those so that you can access the rear leaf spring nuts there. So I've cut around the nut, and then this just snaps over top to hide it. And those carpets come with those little flaps and snaps already installed. So just gotta glue them in place. And next I'm going to start, there's a quarter inch foam that fills in this entire area, just the upper deck area. It comes down and stops here at the lower part. It just goes around the outside of the seats. So I'll glue in that foam first, and then the whole area is covered in a big vinyl cover that comes down neatly, glues and overlaps onto all sides. And then there'll be carpet going along the lower bulkhead here. Okay, moving right along with this BJ8 trimming. As you can see, I got those rear wheel arch sections on, and this is ready for the rear seats to go in now. And I've carried on with first installing the tunnel carpet, which most companies out there choose to do this tunnel in multiple pieces, although that's not what the factory did originally. So Rightway Heritage Trimming, we do it right. We follow the original pattern. This is one piece of carpet sewn with a few darts and that. There is a separate piece sewn in the top there, but it's all one piece that snaps in position and does the whole thing. So, and Carvel carpet, it's quite tight. Mind the shadow from the steering wheel, but yeah, there are some minor wrinkles. That's what they did. Of course, the center console and armrest will cover much of that. And then there's your floor mats, which all just snap in place as well. So these are all cut to fit and as original. There is no binding on any of this stuff. The only binding found even on a BJ8 was just a little bit around the handbrake there. Of course, before I put that carpet in, there's a piece of vinyl that glues to the metal there that just covers that area. So that's all in place with all the carpet snaps, floor mats cut neatly to fit. These rear mats, just like the earlier cars, are just held in with one snap that you can hardly tell. It's right there in the back corner, and the rest of it's just hidden underneath the seat. Of course, the front floor mats have four snaps each in all corners. And I've proceeded, I'm getting ready to start installing panels now. So front kick panels, before this one goes in, you've got to glue this piece of vinyl in behind it, because just on the right-hand side only, all six-cylinder model cars had like an indentation in the metal work there to give you a little bit more toe clearance if this was a right-hand drive car. But all cars were built with that feature. So so there's actually a hole cut out of the kick panel to give you access to that indentation. So you got a covered vinyl there first, and then the panel will go on that has that cut out. And the panel comes back to here, and there's a vinyl flap along the back edge of it that you glue around this flange tightly, and then the door seal pushes onto that so there's no gaps. So we'll be doing that both sides. Of course, the driver's side does not have that indentation. It doesn't need it. So you can prepare that. Obviously, also one more thing that I did do was trim the gear shift hump in black vinyl, which is correct. All BJ8s had black gear shift hump, in spite of whatever the interior color was. And that goes for same thing for the dash top, and the door cappings were always black on BJ8s. They were not color coded to the interior. Okay, so as you can see, carpet set is fully installed and looking really good. I'm just preparing to start installing the panel kit now. So back here in the rear, we got the rear seat cushions installed. They're looking really nice. And of course, you've got to jack the car up and take the rear wheels off to access the nuts and washers for tightening those down. But that's no problem. Got that done. And so now I can put in rear quarter panels, which will cover that area. Although I think I'm going to be going to call the owner and see if we want to address this top frame. It's looking pretty scratched up and ratty, so I'm probably going to potentially retrim these cant rails and just maybe remove the top frame and give it a quick paint job before we go any further with it. And then we can put it back in and button this all back up. You can see over here, I'm getting into just transferring over all of the hardware from the old original rear quarter panels to the new ones. Just go through that. You can lay one on top of the other literally and poke through the original holes and make sure that it's exactly the same. So it should drop right into place. Okay, so rolling right along here. as you can see, I've got the rear quarter panels now installed. I just transferred over those chrome pieces and marked locations of the screw holes from using the old ones as a guide, and installed those, and of course poked through the seat belt mounting bolts. Just ran nuts on there temporarily until we get the belts back in. And then also, I took the liberty, before putting those quarter panels in, I painted the top frame. I actually just cleaned it up and painted it in place, just to give it a quick refresh. It wasn't too bad anyway, so I just kind of cleaned it and degreased it, and of course I covered the whole car with a car cover and just went around where the top frame comes out and had the top frame extended. And yeah, just cleaned it and painted it in situ. And glad I did that. She's got a nice finish on it now. And I've also retrimmed all of the off-white cant rails here. These were all quite rough and vinyl was falling off of them literally. So I cleaned them up and patched the wood where it needed to be done and made some new little rubbers for the bottoms of those guys. And the front header rail, it was actually way too far gone. I think I've still got it over here. Here you can see this header rail, that whole front leading edge was just falling apart, and I have to staple into that with the new topping material. You can see it's just gone and falling apart. So that's no longer good, and that is the front leading edge of the top, so you want that to be a nice clean straight line. It really shows. So we got a new header rail in, and luckily my friend Jason had one in stock, so I was able to run up and grab it and retrim it in the off-white vinyl, and then of course trimmed the new, well, that's the original aluminum header rail strip that this gets trimmed in blue Everflex to match the top. So now I can install all those rails to the top frame and get ready to install the top. Meanwhile, I got the front kick panels in, as you can see. To get those in properly, of course, you've got to loosen off this upper dash/windshield mounting bolt and nut. So yeah, with that bolt out, you just have to slide the quarter panel. Of course, it's hard to see with the seal on here now, but the quarter panel slides up in there, and you can see it just slightly in the darkness there, but it slides under there, and then that bolt goes through it, and then there's the other bolts. There's actually holes in the quarter panel to go around the heads of those bolts, so you get it shoved in, and that's it. And this back edge glues to that flange that the and then the door seal goes over the flange to help hold it all. And that's it. There's no other screws on the left-hand kick panel. It just slides in there, and that vent and the dimmer switch bracket are what hold that front corner. But it's in there quite tight anyway. It doesn't want to move. And then, of course, the center console. I had pre-trimmed that before, so I just had to mount the speaker plate. And there is a blanking plate yet to go in. You can see I've made the holes for it. It's like the black blanking plate, radial blanking plate with a chrome surround, and it has the Austin Healey 3000 lightning flash on it. The thing is, I need those little press-on nuts for the back of it, which I don't have, so they're easy to put in from behind just with your fingers. You just push the thing in through those holes and then feel behind and push on the little nut. And so with that in, and of course there's a screw down here, and there's a bracket back here that helps hold that whole console in place and screws up into the dash top, or into the center dash there, as you can see. So that thing's well in place, and then fit the armrest in, and it just squishes under the console there and then has two screws in the back there. So that's the phase two style center console and armrest. Phase one BJ8s had the console came out to like here, and it had a little shorty armrest on the at the back that actually was like a little cubby box. Phase two, it's just a long padded armrest. There's no box. So, yeah, what else? I'll just show you this side of things. There's the other rear quarter panel installed. Pretty much ready to install the door panels, but I've got to put some clear plastic vapor barrier on there first, and then we can put the panels on. And yeah, here's on the passenger side. Again, had to open this up, just the one bolt that goes through the panel that helps hold the panel in place. And then again, it's just glued to this flange around the back, so there's no gaps. See, the edge of the vinyl just tucks under there. However, on this side, that's where I had put that bit of vinyl, and there's the cutout for that little recess to give you a bit more toe room on this side. And of course, because that's such a flimsy piece, it does have three screws going around. So that's how that goes in. So she's coming right along. So next step, I think, is I'm going to go about installing those cant rails back onto the top frame, and then I'll secure the top frame to the windshield as if it's in fully open position, and go about installing the top. The reason I want to do the top installation now before putting in, I've still got that rear backrest that I have to redo and then put in, but it's kind of the last thing to go in, just because it's really difficult to install the top. Here, I'll open it up like so. She's got a nice car cover there to protect the top of the windscreen, and I can reinstall all of those off-white cant rails that go along here and around the front there. And once those are installed, I can install the webbing straps. These are his old webbing straps, but I can at least use them for length. See how they fit with the new top. And I'll put in new gray cotton webbing straps as original. And then once the webbing straps are in, I can fit the top. Now the reason I want to fit the top now rather than later is because I want to do it before I put in this rear backrest. That's kind of the last piece to go in. It sits up there and kind of gets in the way of trying to attach the top around this rear drip rail. So there you can see there's the drip rail. I've repainted it as well. And you've got to literally clip the top to that drip rail and then screw the drip rail in place along there. So it's quite a tricky process. You need full access back there. It's even a little tricky around those rear quarter panels. May or may not take those out for the process. I've done it with them in place before, but you just got to use a stubby screwdriver on the sides there to get around. But not too bad. So that's what's next. I'll take you through, show you what it looks like with the cant rails on, and then installing the top next. Okay, so I've put the newly covered off-white cant rails. These were always trimmed in an off-white color, no matter what the color of car or trim on BJ8s and BJ7s for that matter. And so with those installed, I was able to measure and install the webbing straps. So it's glued around itself there, and then there will be a strip. You can see it over here. This strip screws in place. Once the top is installed, the top itself has a flap that wraps around this and glues, and then that strip screws in from the underside. And it also catches that webbing strap as well. So that's how that goes in. And then it's got these little clips with screws that it catches on like that, and then goes forward, and then it's just stapled off onto the front header rail there. I always just leave that long until it's all finished in case there's any minor adjustment I have to do. And yeah, so that's good to go. With these cant rails, I installed this is the aluminum strip that the seal will push onto eventually, but I have to leave that off onto these side ones because the top itself has to wrap around here and staple off, and then that aluminum strip goes over it to trap it. So keep these ones without the strips on them, but it is on the front. It's on. It's built into this piece that I've already trimmed in blue Everflex to match the top. So when you get a new top, you always get a strip of this Everflex separate that is meant for this header rail to trim it. So that's all ready to go. So now I can offer up the top, and first thing is first, I've marked my center lines everywhere. So there's one there. That one just uses that center screw, so that's really easy. But I've marked it here again on the bow and here on the body. And just check it with the measuring tape. And again, I've marked it down there on that drip rail. It's crucial that you get your center points all established. I've marked it on both of these. And then of course on the top itself. So that's the front leading edge, and I've marked it on the inside and on the back, and you can see here. So there's that flap that is gonna glue to that rear bow. So it just glues around and glues to itself. So I've marked it clearly where its center line is. So we can lay the top on. First step is to get that rear bow established. So I'll glue that up and then put on that little strip and screw it in place, making sure it's centered and I've got as much stretch as I can pulling out from both sides. You kind of get the center started and then just pull it as you're gluing it along. So you get a nice even stretch going from the center out both sides. So that's the first step. We'll get that bow glued in and then continue on from there. Okay, and the top is all finished. So, order of operation, like I say, once the bows have the webbing straps installed, I started with this rear bow, securing it to the top on the inside. There's a sewn flap that glues to that bow. So starting in the center, you start gluing it and you make sure you pull it tight out to both sides as you're doing it and glue it around that bow. And then once you've got that established, I come along here and I pull these down to where they need to be, and they staple off just in here onto this cant rail wood. So just put a couple staples into those to make sure that's where I want it to be. And then I kind of pull it forward. I leave this until the last, but I do put like just a center staple, not super tight or anything like that, just to keep it up here. And then I work on doing this whole rear section. And the Robin's top, they cut it exactly to shape, so you shouldn't have to cut anything off of it back here. It has just enough to wrap around that this rain channel rail around the edge of it. So there's just enough material to go over the edge and under and put a row of those little clips, the same type of clips that are used on seat material. And so, yeah, they're like every 3 or 4 inches, there's another clip. You fasten it to that rain rail, again, starting in the center and working your way out and pulling it, you know, relatively tight all the way along. I did find on the sides here, I had to pull a little bit, like half an inch more than I had pulled around in the center. And then you gotta fight and use a long awl to pull that rain rail down and line it up with the screw holes and screw it in place. And starting in the center and working your way out to both sides. And that's all there is to it. So once you get that rear section in, it's pretty much done. Then you've just gotta pull the rest of the wrinkles out, pull it forward to the front here, staple it off nice and evenly. Again, starting with the center and then getting these corners set and then working out the wrinkles. And once it's all good, then you put on your hidem strip. You cut off the excess and put on your hidem strip. And then now she's ready to be steamed just for those last few wrinkles, but looking very good. So that is how you do BJ7 and 8 top. And then of course, once the top is in place, I came along and reinstalled the door seals. These fuzzy door seals with the little rubber end caps on them, and they just press on to those aluminum trims. This one goes all the way around the front and around the other side, and then there's another rubber seal that goes up under here, and you just glue that one in place. So, and that's making a very nice seal across the top of the windshield now. We got the new rubber seal, and yeah, that should stop any rain from coming through, as I guess he was getting pretty soaked on his drive here from Ontario. Okay, so what a difference just a bit of steam and warmth makes. So I just went over the whole top, just warmed it all up with my heat gun from the outside, just to soften the material, and you see some wrinkles disappear there. And it also helps it to stretch in position. I recommend anytime you fit a new top, you leave it up for a week at least if you can. Let it sit in the sun, let it really warm up to that position, and you know, it won't be too tight after it gets used to it. And also you'll lose a lot of wrinkles as it kind of shrinks up at the same time. But yeah, a little bit of steam on the inside, and a little bit of warmth on the outside with the heat gun, and there she looks really good. So now I've gone through and I'm getting ready to install all the boot armor cord trim. So you can see I've cleaned out the boot entirely. I just finished vacuuming it all, and of course I vacuumed the interior as well. So it's all nice and clean, so I can put in the front seats now at any point, and then finish off with the door panels, and then of course the rear backrest. So yeah, interior's looking really good. Top's all finished, looking really good. And yeah, we'll continue on with the boot. So here is my boot kit, Rightway Heritage Trimming, all with the hand-rolled binding, as you can see. Hand-rolled meaning it's done in two passes, and the stitching is not visible on the binding face, whereas machine binding has a line of stitching going right in the binding, and it's only done with one pass. So that's the difference. And of course, all Austin Healeys were originally hand-rolled like this. So anyway, got all the pieces here. First piece to go in on any of the four-seater Austin Healeys. They all have the same boot kit from BN4s onward. It was all the same patterns. So first, the piece you put in is the wheel arch cover there. And it has underlap all the way around. Once that's in place, then you can put in this piece, the flat there. And then once that's in place, you can do the sides, both sides, and then the floor mats that go up the sides on both sides, and then the back rear bulkhead wall, and then this piece that goes under here, and then finally the main mat covers it. And once that's in, there's a cardboard or pressed panel board piece that screws in position to cover that gas tank spout. So we'll get into it. Here is the wheel arch piece. It just orients itself like that. Glue it up and put it in. Okay, so coming right along, you can see I've put in the first piece being that wheel arch, and then I followed up with the side piece that goes behind it. You can see the side piece has the binding to give it a nice finished edge, and it overlaps the wheel arch piece. And then once the side piece is in, then you can put in the long floor section piece here. That, again, it has binding that overlaps the side piece. And it has a cutout for that bumper bracket. And then I switched to this side and put in that the section right here first, and then it underlaps, and then you put in the side piece. You have to remove that wood block to do it, and then punch through the holes and reinstall it. And then again, the floor piece, which I'm just getting ready to put in, that's the floor piece. The other side looks identical, just a mirror image of it. So this one's always tricky, getting it in under the battery tray, but it just fits in the same way as it does over here. And then that'll have both sides done, so then I can do the rear bulkhead and the rear piece, and then the main mat just sets in place and we're done. And there we are with the finished boot. So just finished off, I put in that rear bulkhead panel and then poked through the holes and put in the spare tire blocks. Got to make sure you latch this thing in too as you do it, because it hooks up from the underside, which is hard to do if the block's in place already. And then put on the little board there, and of course the gas tank cover, and then I reinstalled his battery, and that finishes it off. So here's the BJ8 rear backrest in place. So I should note that the majority of BJ8s that were built had all vinyl seating in them. So leather was a special option you could pay extra for, but it was quite a rare thing to actually find cars that were done in the leather we found. So by far the vast majority were done in the vinyl. And the vinyl featured, as you can see, the quarter panels were all embossed. Those were always vinyl, but there was also embossing on this rear backrest going across, had the same pattern as those quarter panels. You can see it's like a cross-hatching pattern. And then of course the seat pleats on the front and rear cushions had like a bunch of little squares embossed into each pleat. Majority were done like that with the embossed vinyl. And another feature of the embossed vinyl was all the piping was in a chrome color, which quickly turns to a gold, as we know, with sun exposure. It was originally started as a chrome color. This is an example of the leather seating that you could pay extra for. So it was 19 pleats going across the face, and of course this backrest assembly all unfolds into a lunch tray. So I've already unsnapped it here. You do a halfway thing like this, and then it unfolds again like this, and you've got these little slide locks that go into these quarter panels and hold it up in position, and now you got like a little lunch tray, they call it, or parcel shelf. So, but yeah, that all folds back up. And that back panel board has these metal stiffeners in it, which actually make it do a curve in, so that it gives it a little clearance for these slide latches. So it's all nice assembly, but lots of work, lots of wood, and all specially cut pieces of wood, and it's all individually covered in vinyl, every piece, and then it's all assembled with these chrome hinges and those metal plates like I showed you. So it's quite a intricate assembly building up one of those rear backrests. So yeah, and it just installs. There's three long screws going through into the floor with nuts underneath the floor, and then there's a pair of long screws that come in from either side. You can see it sandwiches the quarter panel here, and these screws come through from the inner wheel arch. So you can see them just above the wheel, right there. So yeah, up in the top corner there. So that's how she goes. And of course, all the top folds down neatly behind that. And this fellow doesn't have his boot cover, but these, you could get a boot cover with these that when the top is folded down behind there, the boot cover just covers the top nice and neat. And it's a big padded assembly. It holds its own shape, so it makes it look really neat. And that's what those other snaps are for, going across the top. I've still got to install, there's another pair of snaps on either side of these snaps for the boot cover. So there's three snaps going along the boot cover, and there's some 10x snaps that go in these front corners. I still got to install those in the new quarter panels. But we're getting there. This is the rear seat area pretty much done, with the exception of those snaps. Okay, so just preparing to install the new door panels. As you can see, I removed all of the original clips that I can reuse in the new panel. It's always good to note the orientation of each one because they do change position as they go around. Another key factor with these BJ8 door panels is in order to get this clip here installed properly, you've got double thickness of panel where one joins the other here, and that's why there's this relief cut so that one can, you know, bend and become a smooth straight line here. So, but often the new replacement panels, this cutout is not big enough for this panel to actually swing under. So I often have to cut that open a little bit further so that this panel can actually clear and get a nice straight line and be on the same plane. So that's one thing you gotta watch out for on replacement door panels for BJ8s. Of course, Rightway Heritage Trimming, when we do them, we're well aware of that, so we always get it right. But so that in mind, these are ready to install. I've already pre-cut the holes. I already kind of held the panel up in place and found out where those holes have to be for the windshield winder and latch. And then I put on some vapor barrier, just some clear plastic. I spray glue the plastic and hand brush the actual car, so it looks messier than it actually is. But you put on some vapor barrier, it's gonna make those panels last a lot longer, having that barrier. And of course, the factory had vapor barrier, so it's good to put some on. So now I can just go about setting the panel in place, getting the front leading edge on first. You see there's this little hook that goes onto the front leading edge. So you get that around the front edge there, and then the panel just fits in place and all those clips can go into the holes around the perimeter. Okay, so there's the panel snapped in place, looking really nice, fits beautifully. I should have mentioned the upper door capping here has to be installed before you put the main door panel on, because the panel overlaps the bottom of the capping there. And you gotta always make sure when you're installing those door cappings that you use extra short screws, because they come right through and you could risk scratching the glass if they're too long. So the factory ones, you can see they were regular, I think like number 8 screws that were cut down on the ends. Just to avoid any scratches or anything. And sorry, not number 8, number 4 or 6, I guess, that were cut down on the ends. And same thing, the number 8 that I'm thinking of are for the actual door handle, which will go in the center of the main panel there. I've just got to locate those holes again. And so now I'm ready to start installing the latch and windshield winder, window winder mechanisms. Here you can see, so this spring assembly, gotta clean it up still, but it'll go on there, and then the actual handle, and the handle's held in place. There's a hole going through there, and you've got these little tapered dowels, so which go through a hole on the actual latch. So you gotta compress the panel in quite a lot, and what I usually try to do is, you fit this area, the chrome surround first, and then I get something plastic and flat to kind of hold it against the panel, and then squish down this plastic and flat as best I can, and then using some curved needle nose pliers, hold that little peg and shove it in there. Once you get it started, you can tap it in with like a tack hammer and drive her home. And the latch up here, you gotta make sure it's pointed up when you install it. It has a similar pin assembly, and its backing plate looks like this. So this goes on first, and you gotta make sure that that elongated hole is in line with the peg that goes all the way through. So you gotta turn it so that it's in line with the peg and it's gonna clear it. And then of course, here's your handle that installs with those little number 8 screws, which as you can see, are cut off. They're not totally pointed. So make sure you've got all your screws cut. Okay, so there we go. We've got both handles mounted, and the windshield winder is also installed and looking good. And also I was able to get some of those little push-on clips to install the 3000 blanking plate in place of a radio. So that finishes off the center console. And now I can go do the other door panel. And that's a wrap. So the BJ8 interior is all complete. It's got a beautiful, nice fitting top. I've gone around and checked all the seals, trying to get him as weather tight as possible. We've got a much better seal across the top of the windshield there. I don't think any water's gonna be able to come through there anymore. And then I put some clear RTV silicone in a caulking gun and just went under that entire lip and just make sure to get a good bead, put it right in the right spot, right where the rubber connects to the body. Put a nice bead there so when the seal closes, it squishes down against that rubber and creates a nice seal. So I especially had to load up the RTV in these corners because you can see right there, it's quite a gap. And the leakage he was explaining he had was just from sitting overnight in a parking lot. I think it was going in under here and just dripping down and soaking his floor mats underneath. Yeah, I put lots of RTV sealant all the way along here, but made sure I loaded it up there to get a nice seal. So leave that overnight and see how it is in the morning. Maybe have to add more, we'll see. But yeah, the rest of the interior is all done. Here's these nice door panels, all done. And here's just door seals and seats are installed. I trimmed these months ago, so these are the leather. So whenever you got leather with the BJ8, they did away with the chrome piping and just had matching vinyl piping. And of course, just plain pleats, there's no embossing there. So it's looking really good. I redid the black shift dome. It was standard on all BJ8s. And yeah, she's looking really good. Oh, I've got this still down still, but kind of hard to see in the shadows, but looking really good here. So now you can see the top frame nicely painted with new gray webbing to match, all those new freshly trimmed cant rails and the off-white vinyl, just as it should be. So that's a wrap. So I'm Geoff Chrysler, owner of Rightway Heritage Trimming, where you can get all of this and more interior trim kits for your Austin Healey. Until next time, see you again.